Good afternoon, everybody. PC Outcast here, back with more ambition, and let's go meet up with our good, bestest, first love interest, Alex. And what should we wear? Is this... I don't think this is the last thing we wore. I think we kind of wore this when Anarad took us out. Even though it hasn't lost any novelty. I don't know, something like that. Provincial thing will probably be fine, although he doesn't seem to really care all that much what we wear. To be perfectly honest. We'll go ahead and wear that though. After spending the first half of the day getting ready, you head out for your rendezvous. You're neither well-dressed nor exhausted. Well, sorry, well-rested nor exhausted. I still need to try resting 2 days in a row and see what the well-rested bonuses. Nothing's holding you back from being your most engaging self. You return to the idyllic Gwagat Peridi, or whatever, which is already packed with enthusiastic patrons clapping in time with a band's music, drinking great gulps of wine and dancing. Alex arrives exactly on time and greets you with a precise bow and broad smile. Bon appétit, midi, something like that. Yvette, it's great to see you. He says, not even taking a second to glance at your clothes, of course. You are once again reminded that military men seem to have little interest in fashion. You've gained a decent amount of favor with Alex. I guess my outfit didn't take away, at least. He glances away from you, taking in your location. Ah, free-flowing drink, raucous fun, and excellent dancing. This is going to be a great day. The two of you don't even get a table. Instead, Alex orders a bottle of wine for each of you, and you both spend the entire day dancing together. By the end of the evening, your legs hurt from dancing, your throat hurts from singing, and it doesn't matter. You're both too happy to care. A few hours later, you realize it's getting late. Starting to get late, and the two of you depart together. Your rendezvous complete, you decide to head home. Alex insists on walking you there, saying that he'd never forgive himself if he let some misfortune befall you. You have been in Paris for quite some time. Do you miss your family at all? Yes and no. I mean, I love them, but I can't be who I really am when I'm around them. He smiles at your reply. I can understand that. If we are a seed, then a family is the soil in which we grow. However, if we stay too close, we might find ourselves wilting in their shade. Okay. Silently, he takes your hand. Conversation dies down somewhat when he takes hold of you, but that doesn't matter. The warmth of his body says enough. You've had every reason to leave Paris, yet you're still here. Why? I just love the people here. There's a passion that I'm drawn to. I feel much the same way, he replies, squeezing your hand gently. More favor. You continue to walk together, sticking near the buildings to avoid getting struck by any reckless carriages that might come barreling down the street. Coachmen these days are paid for speed, not safety. The door of a house suddenly bursts open in front of you. A grim, grimy man steps out. Without a word, this man shoves you out of the way and silently starts marching down the street. His face contorted with anger. Alex yells at the man walking away from you. You, monsieur, halt right now. A dragoon marches over to this man and looms over him, but not with the force of a soldier preparing for yet another fight. There's something else about Alex's demeanor. He is incensed, haughty, and imperious. Have you taken leave of your senses, you loathsome imbecile? Do you think it is acceptable for a man to act this way? You will apologize to her immediately. While taken aback at first, the grimy man who treated you so rudely sneers and replies, I shall do no such thing. Who the devil are you to ask this of me? I am... Alex begins, but halts suddenly. He steps backward, less sure of himself. Oh. I am... His next words are whisper, only you can hear. I am nobody. What? Hey. Monsieur, I am the one you owe an apology to. Or is this how you treat all women? I owe you nothing, madame, he sneers. If you dislike my behavior so much, then don't walk near my house. At this, Alex straightens up again, this time placing his hand on the pommel of his saber. Monsieur, are you sure that's what you want to say to her? Alex looks at you and gives a confident nod. At this, the boorish man feels less sure of himself. He grumbles a half-hearted apology to both of you and scurries away, taking great care to avoid eye contact with either of you. Alex tensely watches the man until he's completely out of sight. The dragoon is shaking a little. Huh. He turns to you with a wide grin as if nothing had happened at all. Sorry about that. I'm normally much better about that sort of thing. Are you all right? I think I should probably ask you about that. What happened back there? Dumas isn't my real surname. It was my mother's. My father forbade me from enlisting under the family name. He felt I would be dragging it through the mud. I wanted to make something of myself, and it only brought him shame. Thank you for asking, Yvette. As you can imagine, I rarely have occasion to discuss these sorts of things. The two of you walk and talk and try to settle yourselves after what transpired. You both do a decent job of it and manage to almost forget that boorish man's attempts to spoil your evening. Before you know it, you arrive at your humble home. Emile doesn't come out to greet you, but given the late hour, that's unsurprising. Bonne night, Yvette, Alex says with a bow. Shall I see you again soon? I need time to think. Tonight was too much. No. But of course! Inside, you gently step over Camille, who happens to be sleeping in the hallway, heading upstairs to undress and to chronicle the evening's events in your journal. You wonder when you'll next learn more of this mysterious soldier. Well, that was strange. And what is Camille? Did Camille just fall asleep waiting for us in the hallway? Is that what happened? Oh dear. Okay, so we've got a wine tasting coming up, so we're gonna want to be rested for that. We're gonna want to wear something that the bourgeoisie likes. Let's just go ahead and rest at home. We can safely skip all of this, I think. Another one. A music recital this time. On the 1st of June. Sure. Sounds good. Wardrobe. Guess we're going to want to wear Honorad's gift. Bourgeoisie is going to like it a lot. Ooh. Gained a considerable amount of credibility. Choice of your outfit has altered your credibility. The level of restedness has not. You gain a piece of cheap bourgeoisie gossip. Yes, here you go. Take that. Excellent. Okay, so we're doing pretty good. We got most of our stuff back. Madame Gazelle is considering the position of the bourgeoisie and how it relates to the crown and the revolution. This feels like a prime opportunity to exert some influence upon her decisions. Okay. Some more cheap gossip. Someone is absolutely bursting at the seams with the desire to discuss something concerning the host, but only with those who know the host well. You might not, but when has such a triviality ever stopped you? You have women discussing their businesses and the rumor that come with such dealings. If one were careful, they could walk away with quite a bit of knowledge indeed. Cheap or shocking bourgeoisie gossip. Outrageous crown gossip. Urgent message. A messenger has arrived at the door bearing pressing information. The scandalous news might be worth quite a bit if one were to obtain it. Ooh, yeah, let's go for it. Strolling through the event, you find yourself in the vestibule of the party venue again. The room is empty as the doorman appears to be off doing something else. You're startled by the sound of a frantic banging at the door. Open the door? You open the door and see a young man. He's sweating profusely, and you can see a horse outside pacing anxiously back and forth. With a word, he steps inside. Once inside, he frantically looks around the otherwise empty room. Excuse me, can you help me find Madame Marie de Lorraine, the Countess de Brion? I have grave and potentially scandalous news for her. Ooh, boy. We couldn't possibly risk you being spotted inside. Tell me the news and I'll deliver it for you.
Huh.
We can't risk it, he says slowly.
Oh-ho!
Mon Dieu, I don't know, madame. You're right. Come closer and make sure to deliver every word you hear to the Countess, and only the Countess. As he frantically whispers details to you, find your eyes opening wider and wider in shock. It's equal parts tantalizing and ghastly. Surely it can't be real, but it must be, otherwise the messenger wouldn't be here. No wonder the Countess needed to hear this immediately. You've gained a piece of outrageous crown gossip. Of course, Pierre would like this information as well, as it's perfect material for his paper. Still, sharing it with a Countess could be hazardous. It could also lead to a reward or improved esteem in her eyes. Now I must be on my way before someone spots me. Curse these courtly intrigues. He takes his leave, and you are left with a valuable secret. Perhaps the Countess should hear of this. I don't think so. I think it'd be better to just keep this to myself. Keeping a secret is easy enough for a woman in your position. With some new valuable knowledge acquired, you decide to look around the rest of the party and see what else you can accomplish. I believe that's our first... That might be our first set of outrageous gossip. Pretty cool. Oh, Honorod and Miss Thang, by the looks of it. More strange noises. I do want to look this up at some point, but not now when we only have one other thing to do. This is just favor with Honorod. I think I want to get more gossip. Give me all the gossip. You find yourself drawn to the telltale signs of an argument. If nothing else, it should be entertaining. Me, monsieur? You're blaming me for the collapse of that bridge? I visited the worksite myself and saw the supplies that you'd sold the builders. The stones had enough cracks in them to resemble a spider's web. Of course, my design didn't hold up. The angels themselves couldn't succeed with such shoddy material.
Oh.
You exaggerate, Garçon. The materials my company supplied weren't as poor as you say. Even if they were, every business has the right to save itself money wherever possible.
Are you even listening to yourself? I don't know why you suddenly turned British. You'd trade your very soul to the devil for a few coins. I think you'd still have struck the better bargain.
Monsieur von Mayendorf? Replies, his expression calm. Christoph van Mayendorf. Gotcha. But his voice is hot, is white hot with anger.
Listen here, you Austrian cur. You do not have the right to speak to me like that. I may not hold a title, but I am still far above your station. I am a regular guest of the lords and ladies at Versailles, and I will be treated as such.
I'm sure the nobles adore you and your refusal to take responsibility for your own failings. However, if you'd actually paid any attention, you would have noticed that the Count at Versailles doesn't quite have the favor of the people in this room. Then again, I can't expect you to notice that. It would require you to pay attention to something other than yourself. Some of the observing guests whisper amongst themselves reprovingly. Even if the bourgeoisie is unhappy with the crown at the moment, one still has to give a certain amount of respect to powerful men like this masonry magnate.
You are treading dangerous ground, Garcon.
Are you sure I am the one that's in danger? Christoph replies, smiling for the first time. I've learned a lot while having the unpleasurable experience of working with you. If you're not careful, some of your indiscretions could become more public.
You see both of them sharply inhaling, about to deliver their next verbal blows. Step in, increase peril.
Or craftsman blames his tools. Ooh, heart. Nope. No, we're definitely not going to get a hard credibility challenge. That's not going to work. A little bit of peril, maybe? Sure.
Esteemed monsieur, did you make your entire fortune shifting blame, or just most of it?
The crowd of onlookers gasps at your snide question. Both the men involved freeze in place. The older man whirls on you.
I ask you to leave us to our business, mother. And now it is not the time for interlopers to inject their opinions where they don't belong.
Ooh.
Oh, are you sure about that? If you were me to ask me, I'd say that Madame Ducot is extremely welcome right now. Ah, to the devil with both then, but with you both then.
Mystery Magnate storms away from the conversation, his face frozen into a permanent sneer.
Thank you for your assistance. Seeing self-important boars get their comeuppance always puts a smile on my face. In fact, maybe you could use this rumor I've heard to ensure his reputation more accurately reflects his character. After all, anything that can be destroyed by the truth should be.
Christoph steps closer and whispers a few choice details to you. You listen carefully, memorizing as much as possible. You've gained a piece of outrageous bourgeoisie gossip.
And now then, if you might excuse me, I have some other business to attend to. My reputation has been damaged enough by that loathsome blockhead that I must find a new project to save my reputation.
Christoph leaves, and you carefully step into a corner so you can write down what you've just learned. Overall, this has been a good use of your time. We only gained 10 peril. That's not bad. That went exceedingly well. We got some cheap bourgeoisie gossip, outrageous bourgeoisie, and outrageous crown gossip. And it cost us 10 gold, 10 livar, a little bit of peril, and we gained quite a bit of credibility. I'll take it. That is not a bad day at all. Oh no, Anurad, I have a party. I can't meet with you. Sorry, girl. Alex. Sure. That's there. Okay, that's done. We need to make our way to Pierre. Oh, thank God you've arrived. They want some stories in the revolution. Fresh gossip. Fantastic.
Now then, on to business, yes?
Yes, on to business, my good man. All right. How much did we get for this? 90. Definitely sell that. Yes. And we'll go ahead and sell this as well. And then this, we are going to peddle to increase the power of the crown greatly. Oh yeah. Good times, man. Good times. How that affected things. Wake up to the sound of Camille begging for money.
Good morning, madame.
Huh.
It is time for my monies. I mean, the rent.
Yeah, here you go.
Uh-huh.
Merci beaucoup.
Off she goes. Okay, so we have 2 days. We can rest one of those days, and then we can do a little bit of running around, I guess. Let's take a look. We got 2 stars. I'm not sure.
I know that they were down to nothing, so we seem to be helping them. Unfortunately, the military has lost quite a bit of credibility. Revolution is still pretty strong. And we're done as far as all of that is concerned. Let's look at what things we can do. Dance together. Balance of power. It appears that some disagreement between members of the Leguette Royal and the military as to who has authority, has true authority in the streets of Paris. Interesting. And there's that. We gotta check that out at some point. But addictions, master of letters, we could continue to pursue Armand's situation. There's not really much else we can do, sadly. Master of letters. I might want to hire him to weaken the revolution at some point. Let's just take a look at our calendar. Yeah, we're gonna get some revolution gossip here in just a couple of days. Do we actually have a wardrobe that the revolution likes? They don't like that. Don't care about that. They don't care about that. They like that a little bit. All right. Okay, you know what? I'm curious about this, although there's a lot of potential peril there. I don't know if I want to hire on a bodyguard, though. I already hired a tailor, and that did not end well, very well. We go and explore more about Armand? Sure. You know what? Finally found your fiancé Armand, and he's invited you to visit him in his new abode. He claims that he'll be able to explain his mysterious disappearance and what he's been doing all this time. Alright, talk up, my dude. It's a long walk to get to Armand's address on the western edge of Paris, but compared to the events of the last month or so, it's as easy as a stroll around the block. The neighborhood is a poor one, but filled with the kind of poor who still feel that they can improve their station. Persons strut proudly down the streets, wearing one or two articles of fine clothing over their worn-out ones, seemingly almost a parody of the wealthy aristocrats who glide about La Place Royale. To them, these one or two expensive things are both a luxury and valuable armor against the sneers and derision of those better off. Time and again, you've seen that the poorer one is, the harder it is to gain someone's trust. In lives like theirs, any scrap of trust could be the difference between survival and complete destitution. Armand must have chosen this address because he wouldn't stand out here. In his fashion of a fine nobleman's jacket and plainer clothes underneath, he'd look like any other proud and desperate man trying to strive for something better. You manage to find Armand's new home, 3 stories tall, but thin and leaning to one side. Feels less like home and more like an old man crippled with age. It reminds you of your own living situation. However, judging from the dust and cracked window panes, he doesn't have anyone like Camille to take care of things. Well, Armand isn't the only one living there. There's also this Joanna woman. You're still uncertain of her role in all of this. Could she be the one who wrote that cryptic letter to him, which he found secreted underneath the floorboards in the kitchen? You knock on the door and hear some movement inside before someone opens the door just a crack to see who it is. Spotting you, Armand flings open the door and bounds outside. Ah, ma chérie! It's great to see you again! Please, come in! Come in! You walk in and he takes your cloak from you to hang it on the coat rack. The inside of the building is remarkably sparse and without any decorations. It feels more like an outpost than a home. Please, make yourself at home. Joanna is out, so it's just you and me for the moment. Armand, I don't know how I feel about this Joanna. Can you tell me more? Oh, but of course, he replies happily a little relieved. You've gained favor. My friend Charles introduced me to her when I first arrived in Paris, and while our organization here has been growing rapidly, I've essentially become her closest confidant. Though she'd never take credit for it, she's the real founder of the society I've become a part of, he says, gesturing to the walls, which are covered in maps and notes. She's clever, tenacious, and she speaks French so well for someone who didn't grow up with her language. You think back on your brief conversations with her, and you never even detected a hint of a foreign accent when she spoke. Why would she put so much effort into sounding exactly like a native French speaker? I'm really glad you see to see you reacting this way, Armand admits. I was afraid you'd be jealous of her. I understand that a man and a woman living under the same roof leads to all sorts of assumptions. I think we can both agree that if there's one thing that life in Paris has taught us, it's that few things are as they appear to be. Like that Corporal Dumas character you've been seeing, if the gossip is to be believed, a humble dragoon from Saint Dominique, who seems to be skilled at nearly everything he does. I imagine there's more to him than meets the eye. He reads your facial expression and holds his hands up innocently. Please, don't take me for a jealous boar, I bet. As I may have said before, I don't blame you, given the circumstances. I'm more curious than anything, as I've never met him. What's he really like? Alex is a fun diversion for me, nothing more, nothing less. Well, a man of that caliber is a simple diversion, and if a man of that caliber is a simple diversion, then I feel quite complimented to know you think of me as something more serious. Oh, yes, I have something to show you, he says, leading you up two creaky flights of stairs to a window. It immediately feels different from the other ones in the house, because you can see that the glass here has actually been cleaned and polished. Look out at all that, he says, gesturing to the city. You're at the very top of a small hill. All the buildings in this neighborhood are short, lending you a remarkably clear view of Paris. I come here to think every day, to think about the responsibility I have to these people. Pardon me. The responsibility I have to these people. While I'll never see them all, I can see their houses, their workplaces, and all the places that serve as the stages for their lives. Few of them will ever have the power to change things, sometimes by the mere circumstances of their birth. Still, that only makes it even more important that I do something right. That's why I joined this group. The Frankish Habsburgian Society in Austria. The House of Habsburg has managed reforms for more effective governance, religious tolerance, land reforms, and more. Here in France, we have a battle brewing between two disastrous powers. First, there's the aristocracy, who would march our country off a cliff if it allowed them to preserve their privileges for another day, and the revolutionaries, who can only agree on what they wish to tear down, but not on what they'll build afterwards. Her Majesty the Queen was born Maria Antonia Josepha Joanna, daughter of the Empress of Austria. Her brother, Joseph II, is the Holy Roman Emperor. If our two countries were brought together under a single rule, France would have the resources to solve its immediate crisis and the political will necessary to do away with our more backwards traditions. Ah, so that is what Joanna's is all about. She wants basically make a move to unite the Holy Roman Empire, specifically Austria. Austria and France. Wow. Every single day I look at this window and think of all the people we could save. Armand, are you aware that this is treason?
Yeah.
You're right. It's treason. The highest crime imaginable. Murder and theft are also crimes, but the ancestors of every king and queen in all the world gained their dominions through conquest. Still, years later, we celebrate their crimes as victories. We will break the law, yes, but it's in service to a good that's greater than any law. Can't you see that? Armand stares silently at the window, looking out at Paris and its people. You stare with him. Without a word, he grabs you by the wrist and pulls you closer. You rest your hand in the crook of his shoulder and realize that you'd nearly forgotten how it felt.
Huh.
The two of you watch the sun set on the city together. The lights of the city slowly appear like a second set of stars. Quietly says, I have to leave for a meeting tonight. More secrets and skullduggery. We have something coming up that will involve convincing a lot of people to our cause. And I think you'd be perfect for it. I'll have someone leave a message with Camille when we get close to the date. You can stay here for a little while longer if you like. And I trust you to let yourself out. Nope. I'm gonna steal everything you own while you're gone.
Ooh.
Oh, villainous woman. Please have mercy. I am but a poor baron who has fallen on hard times. The two of you spend the next few minutes giggling as you chase each other around the house. You keep trying to steal various books and silverware while he keeps trying to put the purloined items back in their proper place. Eventually catches you trying to walk away with his broken grandfather clock, and you both collapse in fits of laughter. Armand is just about to leave before he turns back to you and says, I just wanted to say that I never stopped thinking about you. In fact, I still have all the letters you wrote me locked away in my desk. With a gentle smile, he departs for his meeting, leaving you alone in his house. You relax and assess your situation for a while before leaving yourself. Alone, you walk down the nighttime streets by yourself, considering all you've just learned. Fantastic! I've finally managed to find my fiancé, and I'm an accomplice to treason. Your head hangs heavy, as if a millstone has been placed around your neck as you trudge home. You spend the long walk home through the dark, wondering how exactly you'll manage to rescue yourself from this latest set of dangers. No good, man. Especially considering we're siding with the crown. And on that note, we will wrap this episode up. Thank you very much for joining me, guys. We'll see you tomorrow.